The great Sugar Ray Leonard once said, when Michael Buffer introduces a fighter, it makes him want to fight. His is one of the most famous faces in sport, and his catchphrase has electrified main events right around the globe. Five words that are now synonymous with live world championship boxing.
Let's get ready to rumble!
So when Michael offered Boxnation a rare interview, we jumped at the chance to meet the man behind the microphone.
Michael, welcome to Glasgow. You're looking immaculate, incredibly sharp as always. Do you ever suffer from jet lag?
Yes, I do sometimes. Right now my wife is sound asleep in the middle of the afternoon and I could almost join her, but I'm a little excited to be here. So it's, my juices are starting to flow now.
And we're hours away from the Burns-Mitchell fight that has captured the imagination, certainly in the UK, and you are saying in the USA as well.
Yes, it has, and especially on the internet. A lot of interviews, a few with me, and it's good to see fighters get talked about like this in a really big time fight.
Just give me an indication of your preparation before a fight like this one tonight. Have you got all that done? Will you do it when you get to the arena? How do you prepare?
I got in a few hours ago because I did have to work elsewhere last night. And I'm going to have to get the names of the officials and the sanctioning executive directors and chairmen and judges, referee, fighters' records, hometowns, and know exactly how they want their nicknames to be spoken, and that's pretty much the preparation. I'll sit down, and of course I have to write it in very big letters because my eyes aren't what they used to be, and I have to make sure I don't want to wear my glasses in the ring.
So how important do you feel it is for you to get all those pronunciations spot on?
Very important, because I'm a fan, and I want to know if I look at this tape later on, I want to know that I did my best, and I did my best for the fighters, because they're the stars of the show, and they deserve every bit of attention and perfection you can deliver.
You talk about looking at the tape or the DVD probably these days. Are you as self-critical as the fighters would be then when you look at your own performance?
I'm the worst when it comes to my own performance. I'm never satisfied. I'll find something I don't like and try not to do it, or try to do it better all the time. Mm.
Do you keep those things to yourself, or do you confide in other people when things upset you?
I confide in my wife, and she tells me I'm crazy, but I said, no, I know better.
Now, Michael, if we wind the clock back, was that right, that the idea of being a ring announcer came to you from one of your kids when you were sitting watching television, watching someone else perhaps not doing it as well as you do it now?
Watching a fight 30 years ago, and one of the great moments in boxing is a split decision, especially for an announcer, for an MC, and you'll say fighter A, fighter B, and the room just gets quiet because say, and the winner by split decision, and if it's a championship fight, you're going to say either and new or and still, the heavyweight champ. So you live for that moment. And we watched a fight on television 30 years ago. The announcer gave the decision, but after he gave the first two scores, you knew who won the fight. And my son, Dad, he was 13 at the time, he was 40-something now, and he said, you could do that, I bet you. And sort of like a little light went off in my head, and as a fan, I thought, well, that'd be great if I could get my foot in the door and be there at ringside and watch the fight just as well.
When you have those decisions to announce, when you're the only guy, really.
Supposedly the only guy,
although news does tend to leak out sometimes. How much of a feeling of power does that give you, and what do you do to preserve the fact that you're the only guy in the whole place that knows the decision, and you're the only person who can impart?
It's interesting you would put it that way. I never thought of it as a feeling of power, but you have a feeling of drama. Especially if it's a super fight with big names on television, and you can get to that third score and turn it into a cathedral. You can just make it dead quiet, and because they'll cheer for the one guy, they might boo for the other, and then it's that third score, and you own it. You take that little three or four heartbeats before you give the announcement. It's a great feeling.
Do you prolong the agony deliberately?
Of course. The agony the agony of defeat and the joy of victory.
To the winner by split decision, the fighting pride of Australia from the last...
So, Michael, how long was it after your son said, Dad, you could do that and you could do that a lot better? How long was it before you actually broke into the game and took up MCing?
At the time, I was living in Philadelphia, 60 miles from Atlantic City, who had just brought casinos and gaming industry and lots of fights to bring the customers in, and they were all on television and everything. And so I called the commission, and this was 30 years ago. The commissioner was like, well, if you get hired by somebody, we'll give you a license. But it wasn't like I could go get a license and then and go out and start looking for the work. And eventually I got my foot in the door at with the director of entertainment at the old Playboy Hotel and Casino in Atlantic City, which since has changed names. And she went to a promoter who was doing fights there a couple times a month and said, you know, we'd like to use this guy. Of course, she was looking at a resume that wasn't too legitimately factual. You know, I might have said I had a little bit of experience, you know.
One or two people
and,
have done that.
Sure, a little white lie.
You're not alone.
I think the 8x10 headshot got me through the door because they wanted like an image type of a thing, and I was dreadful. I mean, I was really bad. And I got another chance again like 4 or 5 months later, and like I said, watched the replay and said, wow, that's bad, don't do this. In this case, I changed everything and made it better. What you see today, 30 years later.
Just bearing in mind that very nervous and unsuccessful first night, Michael. What about here tonight in Glasgow? You'll have the odd flicker in the stomach, with the odd little bit of nerves. If you didn't have it, you wouldn't be a performer.
Yeah, a little bit of nerves. But, you know, after 30 years, the anxiety is still the excitement of a big fight.
We've got a few seconds to go, and I've got butterflies from anxiety of just wanting to have some fun as a fan. It's going to be really electric in about 5 minutes.
And, you know, we're going to have 10,000 people here tonight at the SECC. They're going to be packed into every available seat and standing in the back and just squeezing in toward ringside. And that gets me going. I mean, I love that type of feeling. So I'll be operating more on adrenaline than I will on experience or nerves or anything like that.
People will find it very strange, you know, Michael, looking at you here, that the super cool, super smooth Michael Buffer was once a trembling wreck on the first night.
Trembling. I mean, the worst. It's amazing. And that was after driving that 60 miles in my car by myself, just repeating, you know, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Playboy Hotel, you know, just like trying to like learn, memorize everything. If anybody pulled up next to me at a red light, they would think like, you know, this guy's an idiot. There's, look at this guy talking to himself. So, yeah, bundle of nerves, but it worked out.
After that dodgy first night then, how long was it before you were accepted as part of the boxing establishment? And it was accepted that no big fight is actually a big fight unless Michael Buffer is there.
That's nice of you to say. But the first time, that was in October of 1982, and it wasn't until March of 83 I got another chance. It was on national TV. Did my best, corrected the mistakes as best I could, even though if I look at it today, I would say, oh my God, that was terrible. But, you know, it was... at that time, much better than the first time, and did what they told me to do. And it was very important with timing and when to shut up and when to make sure the fights can get over and they can go on to their show that's afterwards. Timing is important. And so I just, you know, paid attention and pulled through. But that was in March of 83, and a few months later in June, Roberto Duran fought Davey Moore at Madison Square Garden. And I talked Bob Arum at Top Rank Boxing into letting me be the MC. And it was a great night. And I can honestly say that was like a turning point where, especially before the main event, there used to be a tradition, television doesn't show it that much anymore, but where the MC would introduce the famous greats that are at ringside and bring them up into the ring. And when I was a boy, it was really exciting to watch a big fight, and the announcer would introduce Sugar Ray Robinson or Jack Dempsey, and they would come up and shake hands with each fighter and all that. So we had a lineup of great fighters, and it was a pay-per-view show. Time wasn't a problem, and at the time it was Marvin Hagler had the title, and we had Ray Boom Boom Mancini there, Larry Holmes, Jerry Cooney, and Muhammad Ali was there. And I brought him, I saved him for last, and I just had all, on my own, I just had all these guys stay in the ring. There was like a dozen, and they lined up. And then I introduced Muhammad Ali, and they had that great sound system. It was a sellout with 19,000 people. And I said a few words, and I said, "He is known as, and perhaps he really is." And then I did a little bit of a, "The greatest of all times." And the place went crazy. And I, you know, I said, "The three-time heavyweight champion." And I've never been nervous since. It was such a great feeling. It was so exciting that to this day I get goosebumps just thinking about it. A great moment for me.
You've got a real sense of drama, Michael. Have you had any acting experience in your life?
No, I had done some commercials and some speaking parts and some pitches, and no training and no real acting. And I thought about acting a few times, but they work really hard and long hours, you know.
So
I
not like
I,
you.
I passed on that. I've done quite a few movies, and it's you know, you get up at 4 a.m. and you're on set at 5, and I kind of like what I'm doing.
If you love boxing, you're gonna love this.
Their speeches changed the world. Today we have new challenges. So Unilever presents Speeches for a Brighter Future.
I recently read that 4 million children and adults aren't being properly fed by today's standards. The gap between what I have in comparison to others is upsetting, but a feeling isn't enough. A feeling doesn't feed a hungry person. We need to turn our feelings into action.
Help Unilever and Oxfam defeat hunger in the UK at projectsunlight.co.uk.
Delicious new recipe bases. Maybe I cook tonight.
Delicious, good, Sophia.
Maybe you cook every night, huh?
When's your dolmio day?
And what about that voice? Have you had any training on it, or is it just a lucky gift from above?
A public address system is a blessing because, I mean, you can hear me now, and funny you would mention that because this is my speaking voice, but I have an announcing voice, and you have a great sound system and a great microphone in your hand, and that helps out a lot. Just last week in Las Vegas before the Martinez-Chavez fight, I called security to escort me down to get our car to take us to the arena. And I could tell he was like, "Is this really Michael Buffer? Because you don't sound the same." I said, "Well, how about this?
Could I have a security guard walk me down to the door?"
He said, "Oh, yeah, okay, Mr. Buffer, fine."
You can turn it on like that. And what about, listen, the Ready to Rumble catchphrase? I mean, I had the Rumble in the Jungle, of course, but you tried one or two other ones, didn't you? You floated, and they
once
didn't
again,
exactly float.
Once again, my story goes back to Ali, and where he used to say, you know, he was a master of a salesman and a showman, and he would have these great weigh-ins where he would, you know, recite poetry and float like a butterfly, sting like a bee, rumble, young man, rumble, and he would look at the camera and go, "Ah!" And so it was. So that phrase was there, and he would say, "I'm ready to rumble." And I kind of, like, you know, I picked up on that. But, you know, like you said, I tried man your battle stations. You know, ladies and gentlemen, man your battle stations. Nothing. You know, fasten your seat belts. But I tried this, let's get ready to rumble. Not a great reaction, but I liked the way it felt. You know, and I wanted something to get the crowd back into the fighters' introductions, because I just got done introducing three judges, a referee, an executive director, four commissioners, four doctors, and I've killed the crowd. You know, that electricity that we had before, now I needed to bring them back, and it started to work out.
So what about Muhammad Ali? Did he ever pull you to one side and say, hey, you stole my line? Did he?
No, he... The one thing I always get a kick out of, and even though it's his voice is that's hard to hear, but once we became acquaintances, and that's even just a dream to know that Muhammad Ali knows who I am and knows my name, and he would always get that little twinkle he gets in his eye, and he would say, you know, you think you're pretty, but I'm still prettier than you. I love him. He's great.
You've announced thousands of fighters, but which ones have you got close to? Which ones can you count as friends?
Yeah, well, you know, after doing this for 30 years, there's been quite a few fighters through the years that I've, you know, Oscar De La Hoya came out of the Olympics and I announced almost all of his fights. And so you become friendly with a fighter and you become, of course, you're a fan and he's fighting someone else that you also, you know, like and admire. So you have to, in one night, you'll have the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. A good example was when George Foreman knocked out Michael Moore, and I'd known Michael Moore since he was 19 years old, and I knew his mom and his family and all that. And as exciting as that moment was, when Foreman, with, you know, 1-2-1-2, out cold, became heavyweight champion of the world at age 110, I felt just as bad to see, you know, Michael on the floor. But that's part of what we all love about sports.
You're a huge boxing fan. You're a very, very knowledgeable boxing fan as well, sparing your blushes. What is it about the modern fight game or fights in general that you see and makes you annoyed, makes you upset, things that you don't want to see?
I still don't like everybody else, mismatches. You know, sometimes a promoter realizes there's something there in a certain fighter and they want to... build up his record, so that, you know, they sort of spoon feed him a few guys. But, you know, then you have when Sugar Ray Leonard came out of the Olympics, I mean, he just started fighting the best. And when he was fighting in his 8th, 9th, and 10th fight, he was fighting ranked fighters. I love that, somebody that realizes they're a good fighter and they want to fight the best. So mismatches, I don't like. Bad decisions, you know, we all cringe at a bad decision, which it's going to happen, because occasionally one of the judges don't see it the same way, and occasionally two of the judges won't see it the same way, and it literally throws a victory to the wrong fighter. It happens, but hopefully not that much.
You're a boxing fan above all. Do you think the sport is successfully fighting its own corner? Because the sport has got to fight for its own existence, really, its own future, hasn't it?
Yeah. If anybody thinks boxing is dead, you go on the internet and find one of these websites that shows you the fights that are happening, you know, this week, next week, over the months. A lot of fights in a lot of places. People are comparing MMA to boxing and saying, my God, look at the crowds, look at the viewing audience. Yeah, but there's not as many competitions happening this weekend and next. You'll have the UFC, my brother announces for that. I mean, they do huge box office because they have hardcore loyal fans, and that's great, that won't miss any of their events. But if there were 1,000 MMA shows every 6 months like there are boxing shows, it would be a lot different. Boxing, I mean, look at tonight, a total sellout. Last week in Las Vegas, in the same city, two sites sold out with a total of about 30,000 paid. The Klitschkos in Germany and Poland, and soccer stadiums with 50 and 55,000. Joe Calzaghe in Cardiff, 50,000 fans. So, you know, it's boxing's alive and well.
Yeah.
As long as we have good fighters, attractive fighters, and good matchups, that's what's going to make it.
Michael, the last time we spoke on Boxnation was a couple of days before Hey Chisora at Upton Park, right next to the
Olympics, on the pitch.
The Olympic Stadium just around the corner, wasn't it? What did you make of that night?
Great night for boxing. Raining, 30,000 plus fans, just elated, exciting. David Hay answered a lot of questions as to whether he should still be in the ring. He looked fantastic and fought a brilliant fight against Chisora, who in losing really gave Vitali Klitschko fits. And Hay fought the way he should have fought when he fought Vladimir. Stood his ground, very strong in the clinch. I don't just mean with punching power, but physically strong and a great athlete. So I think a case can be made for him to get another title shot. It was a great night for boxing, especially in London.
Michael, I believe I'm right in saying you announced the Hatton-Mayweather fight a couple of years back. What do you make of Ricky Hatton announcing he's coming back into the ring?
We have to wait and see how he looks, how dedicated he is. You know, he's still a young man, 34, I think, right? I think at this stage, if he comes back, looks good in his first fight, and decides to continue on, I think he should try to really be dedicated between fights to staying in good physical shape. You know, he always came into the ring in good physical shape, but he would be, you know, a blimp. You know, he would joke about it, Ricky Fat, and wear the fat suit and all that. But at this age, you have to be very true to your physical condition. And if he does that with the skills that he has and the excitement and energy that he brings to boxing. You know, when he would fight in Las Vegas, thousands of loyal Brits would show up, and it was fantastic.
Seems to me that British boxing fans, Michael, really take you to their hearts, not only in the arenas, outside in the streets as well.
I was honored to be inducted into the Hall of Fame this past June. And in my speech, I brought up a lot of questions that I'm always asked. You know, what's your favorite fight? What's your favorite? And who are the best fans? And I said at the Hall of Fame, the British fans are the best fans in the world that I've seen with 30 years experience, because they're passionate, of course, but they're loyal. I've never seen fans as loyal as the fans in the UK. When Calzaghe, Nazim, Ricky Hatton would fight at Madison Square Garden and in Las Vegas, one time in Detroit with Nazim, thousands of Brits would show up. I don't think if an American fighter came here or goes, you would see thousands of Americans show up. I mean, even though they would have a following, it's like, okay, I'll watch on TV. But I mean, when Hatton fought in Vegas, you had thousands of fans that couldn't even get tickets, but they just wanted to be there. That's loyalty.
How important is it then, from your point of view, to have a real relationship, an empathy, if you like, with the fans?
Yeah, for me, I'm a fan enjoying the fans, you know, because I have a job that, you know, I just kind of like fell into it, loved it, and stayed with it. Probably the first guy to do this for a living. And I always like to have a rapport. I always like to think of myself, I said recently in an interview, that if I know that a father and son are driving out of the parking lot, or they're, you know, getting on the bus to leave the event, and a 12-year-old kid says, "Hey, Dad, when that guy said, 'Let's get ready to rumble,' man, that was great." And then I know I've done my job. I mean, then I know I've really you know, done something I want to accomplish.
And by the way, you'll have seen the effect your announcement has on the fighters themselves when they're in the ring.
Yeah, I've had some guys say some really nice things. Yeah. Ricky Burns said some things a few weeks ago in an interview. It was lovely. It was really, really nice. They said something to the effect that years from now, he'll want to replay it just to hear me introduce him. And that really, I can't think of a greater compliment.
Can you say a legend like Michael Buffer obviously coming into your training room for a foy? I had to make the most of it and get me sign a pair of gloves for us.
Sugar Ray Leonard once said that when Michael Buffer introduces you, you'll want to fight. And you know, things like that are really a high form of flattery and a compliment.
So what about you then, Michael? You're at the peak of your power still.
You're
still doing a job terrifically well. But listen, you're on planes all the time. You're dashing from city to city. Are you going to slow down a bit? Are we going to see slightly less of you?
Or is I want to slow down.
Is it still pedal to the metal all the way?
Jim, I'm going to be 68 in a few weeks. And, it does get a little... it's a little tough to catch a plane. And, just in the last 4 weeks alone, it's been Moscow, Austria, Germany, Belgium last night. I'm here in Scotland. And, you got to remember, I'm doing what I love. And I don't think whether you're a baseball fan in America or a basketball fan or a football fan here or Bundesliga in Germany, whatever, when you get to go to the games and the matches and the things that you love to do, it's you're living large. So it's hard to pull back.
That has to be the secret, doesn't it? Doing a job you love.
Yeah, just imagine all those people every morning that have to drive to work to a job that they hate, and there's a lot of us out there. And so I've been lucky enough to when I go to my job, I'm really enjoying myself.
Brilliant, Michael. We appreciate your time. You've given us a lot of it this afternoon as well. And have a great night. It's always good to talk to you on Box Nation.
Always good to talk to you.
Thanks.